Hello, sir.
What's going on, Jaret?
How are you, man?
I'm 10 times better for seeing and hearing you. It's been a very long time, man, and it's quite a time to be alive.
Man, you said it. You said it.
Where do we even start? I guess we should start with the last year. Let's just go in on that to begin with. How did you go into this whole situation, Jaret? Were you in a good place mentally, spiritually, emotionally when this thing started? Were you was your house in order, so to speak, at the beginning?
You know, that's kind of a frustrating aspect of the whole thing. I mean, to be fair, yeah, everything was awesome. And we had planned, you know, by design, a year of Bowling for Soup, doing like 2 weekends a month. But the way that we had the shows scheduled and stuff, I mean, just income wise, it was going to be a really great year with not as much being away from home. And we did our tour in the UK last February. It was amazing, amazing start to the thing. We came back. We did one other show, and that was like the Friday before the world just shut down. And so at first, it was kind of, you know, I mean, it was like, to be honest, you know me, I mean, I was almost sort of poking fun at the idea of, you know, us all, I'll shut that down.
Thanks,
us
man.
All being, you know, so scared of something, because just quite frankly, it's not something that we had ever experienced. None of us, I mean, our planet hasn't experienced anything like this, you know? So, you know, a show got canceled here, a show got canceled there, and then another show, and then another show. And then I started to, you know, I've had my struggles mentally and, you know, with mental health and depression, anxiety, and I started to have a really hard time. And so I just one day just got up and did a show online. And man, it was exhilarating. You know, it was a couple hundred people watching. And so roundabout sort of answer, I was not doing well at all. So what I did, what I kind of attributed to that too, was my calendar was disappearing. And I, for 25 years, have lived a life to where it's like, okay, you're gone during this time. And then you're home. So this is when you take care of all of your stuff and you spend time with your family. Then you're gone here, and then you're back, and then you're gone, and then you're back. And so my calendar is always full. Well, you know, late March last year, I looked at my calendar and it was literally empty. And Fridays were the same as Sundays, and Mondays the same as Saturdays. And it was a lot. Just interacting with people wasn't a thing anymore. You know, and that's something that I, you know, just being able to make people smile is something that gets me going in the morning. And so what I did was I did the only thing I knew how to do, and that's I just found ways to fill my calendar. So I did over 100 shows in 6 months. I played a ton of shows on stage at every charity that asked me to do something. I said yes. And I just filled my, and then I wrote a bunch of new music, and I wrote a new Bowling for Soup album, and I wrote a country record. And, so yeah, I mean, you know, I managed to get through it. You know, my wife was like, I was locked in the studio. You know, my wife was like, it's like you're on tour, only you come to bed, you know? and quite frankly, that's the way that it felt. You know, I really was, in this room for 8 or 10 hours a day and whatever it was. And, you know, I'm lucky enough to have, the job as Chuck E. Cheese, the mascot for the pizza chain, and they kept me pretty busy. And so, you know, managed to, it's hard for me to it's hard to fathom that it's been over a year. I was talking to Frank Turner the other day, because he and I, for the first 3 or 4 months, did a thing called Back to the Metal, where every Wednesday we just went live on Instagram and just chatted about whatever came to our minds. And he's doing a guest spot on my country record. And I said the other day, I go, you know, it's been a year since Back to the Metal. And it's like, it's hard to even fathom, you know, just such a weird, weird thing.
Yeah. And I mean, have you gained any positives from the process of being at home and having all that time to reflect and go inwards, because I know from my point of view, and we're the same in many ways, and one of those key similarities between you and I is I'd say we're both workaholics. And
yeah, for sure.
We throw ourselves wholeheartedly into being creative, being productive. That's what brings purpose and meaning and direction and, you know, happiness really to both our lives. And, you know, I, in the same way, saw all my DJ work evaporate, and, you know, I knew all my face-to-face podcasting was going to be going out the window. And so initially, I think like you, it was panic stations. And then I got really lucky. I got offered a book deal. I threw myself into that. I started podcasting more regularly over Zoom and phone and things. And then actually, once I got through that initial grieving, because for me it was, and I'm sure it was for you as well, it was like a process of grieving, wasn't it? Because originally you think, okay, this will be over and done within a couple of months, and then we'll be back to it. And then you realize that's not the case. And so you really start to grieve for the communities and the industries that we're a part of.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, and sort of trying to take stock of how everybody else is doing. I mean, I think that's, you know, yes. So I did, I mean, I gained a lot from this. I mean, I gained the fact that I, first of all, yes, you're right. I mean, like you, I am a workaholic, and, you know, and part of my issue with it is that it's what I like to do. So when you say, do you have any hobbies? Yeah. My hobbies are writing songs, telling jokes, you know, make what I do for a living, you know? I mean, so when I'm up here, I don't always even feel like I'm working. And so sometimes I can go 12, 14 hours and my wife will just be like, hey, you want to come down here and, you know, maybe like live your life. And I'll just be, oh shit, I didn't even think about the fact that, you know, that, because this is just what I do. And that doesn't happen a lot. I mean, I do try to keep that in mind. And at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, put my phone on the bar and just, you know, be in the present with my family. And, you know, I got to spend a year with my 7-year-old who's now 8 that I, you know, I wouldn't take back any of that time. I mean, unfortunately my teenage kids were at their mom's and, you know, didn't really see them much over the year. But you know, luckily we have text and all of that stuff. But yeah, same thing. It was definitely a grieving period. And then when I found, you know, I was proud of myself for, you know, for keeping an income stream happening and for keeping the fans engaged and for, you know, and there's a whole new sort of fan base started up called the Kazoo Crew, which is around just me playing these shows online or whatever. And, you know, all of them there for each other and this whole community of people that are just, you know, supporting each other and all of that, you know, something that Bowling for Soup has delivered for so long, but really on my own, you know, it's not really something that I've sat in this room to do, you know? And so that was cool to see. And yeah, I mean, you know, just being able to keep myself busy. And again, you know, I was really worried, man, because I, you know, a lot of people, I think, don't realize that the bands of our age, the, you know, people that sold as many records as us stopped making money on it in the 90s, you know? So yeah, Third Eye Blind has all the money in the world, but you know, you got to understand that when us and our peers were coming up through this, it's the beginning of file sharing and LimeWire and Napster and stuff. And, you know, I'm not rich and famous. I'm just famous, you know? And so I have to work every day.
You make your money on the road, man.
I do. I make my money on the road and that's how I pay for my family's, you know, education and where we live and food on the table and all that. So it was very scary at first. You know, but again, you know, I've just always been like that. I always can just sort of find what, okay, so this is the lane that I'm going to be in for now and we're going to do it. And, you know, came out of it pretty mentally healthy and stuff. I mean, again, I'm vaccinated now, so I realize the world is still not out of this mess and I'm still wearing my mask and doing my part. Our world is still really small, just our bubble that we've been with the whole time, but we can see a light at the end of the tunnel. We're starting to put shows together now. And, you know, and so I can honestly say that I, you know, I came through it without a breakdown, which, you know, I tell you one thing that I, that somebody said to me early in all of this. And again, it's been over a year ago and it's so weird to think about that I had to sort of like every day present this to myself. You know, just a random friend of mine just typed out, and it's super random. It's like somebody from high school that I don't even really talk to. They're just on my Facebook or whatever. And they were just like, you know, you don't have to clean the garage. You don't have to lose weight. You don't have to, you know, redo a room or paint your house or
learn a language or bake bread.
Yeah, exactly. You don't have to learn to cook or learn a language or start a garden. You know, all of these other things that people are doing or whatever. You don't have to do that. We're in a pandemic. All you have to do is survive. And I was like, my God, that is so simple. I just gave myself chills. It's so simple, but it spoke to me. And, you know, and it made it to where I was just like, okay, you know, because, you know, I've put on weight over the years. And that was kind of one of the things where I was just, okay, well, I've got this chance. I'm going to lose weight. Now, we moved into this house 8 years ago and our garage is still a nightmare. You know what I mean? It's just like, okay, I'm going to accomplish all of this. And when you start to put that stuff on yourself, you wake up and you're like, well, I haven't accomplished that yet. So you're like, well, shit, you're a piece of shit, Jaret. You know, like, just go lay back in the fucking bed, you know? And then, but you know, I got myself to that point quickly where I was like, man, I'm just going to survive and fucking just do my thing. And so, yeah, I mean, you know, and even, you know, the other really hard part was not being around the guys. And we figured that out early. You know, poor Chris has been locked in his apartment by himself for 14 months now. And, you know, he lives alone with Wally and, you know, we're 30 minutes away from him. And even if we wanted to, we kind of couldn't spend time together because, you know, we're our kids are going to school. And, so, you know, lots and lots of FaceTimes, hangouts, texting all day, every day, and just trying to keep those ties. And, you know, it definitely has made me even more than when we took the break in 2013, really, really miss them. And so there's a bond, I think, with our band that has actually been strengthened, if that's even possible. Because as you know, you spent a lot of time with us. We're real, real tight. It's even more now. Pretty crazy.
I think with this last year, like, my friendship circle has been so drastically reduced. And that's not been a conscious thing. I just sort of woke up one day and realized, like, wow, what used to be this huge extended circle of, you know, not hangers on at all, but, you know, like loose affiliates and casual acquaintances and, you know, people that you see when you go to events and shows and festivals and pubs, you catch up with loads of people at once because they're kind of just there. But when you remove yourself from those social situations, you sort of realize who the people you want in your life are, the kind of people you want to be surrounded by. And those friendships, if they're real, which obviously yours with your bandmates are, and many people in my life that I knew were before, but after this, I'm like, wow, the same deal. Like, we're closer than ever. And this experience has really, like, been a test of that friendship, but also it's been what's gotten me through. Thank God for even just phone calls, man. Like, the Zoom thing is great, but just like, and it brings back to why I do this podcast. Like, for me, there is no greater high or experience than connecting and having a deep conversation with somebody that you love. That's worth, you know, everything in the world to me. And I'm sure you're the same.
Yeah. You know, it's funny you say that. I sort of said this thing early on. I was like, you know, in your culture, you guys say, you all right? And then the next person says, not too bad. And then you move on with the day, right? We say, how are you? Doing great. How are you? Great. And you move on with your other thing. Those are what our two cultures, that's the intro, pretty much the standard intro to all conversations. And what I found was, it was like, I started asking people, hey, how you doing? And I actually listened to their answer. I wasn't just waiting for a doing great. Like, and people started listening to how I was doing. It was like, and then it became like this, you know, but, you know, hey man, how are you adjusting through all of this? You know, because, and people would ask my wife all the time, like, you know, how is he? Like, this guy has been entertaining people for 25 years and is now like, and I didn't fucking leave, man. I mean, like, my wife did a few things here and there and like went to work or whatever, but like, I mean, I didn't have any reason to. I was just locked in this house or my friend Derek's house or my friend Casey's house. Or my mother-in-law. I went four places in a year, you know, didn't go out to eat, nothing. And, you know, that was the thing was, is that again, back to my point, I don't mean to like get back into the whole thing, but you really, we started listening to each other and how we are doing and what our feelings are and how we're getting through this and, you know, what the impact of it is. And if somebody actually, you know, in American culture, you always say, is there anything I can do to help? You need anything? But you hope that they go, no, I'm good, because that's what you do in conversation, right? Somebody's like, hey, I'm moving this week. And you go, you need any help? They're going to go, no, we got it. Because if they go, yeah, exactly. Because if they go, yeah, we actually could use some help. You're like, ah, fuck. Well, I can't help you, but my friend Jim, you know, yeah. he has dick to do that day. But yeah, I just found that we as people and you know, I do a couple of podcasts as well.
I know you do. You were early doors with this medium.
Absolutely. Yeah. I got into the Bowling for Soup thing back in 2009, but 6 years, I guess, doing Jaret Goes to the Movies and 3 years doing Rockstar Dad now. And with Rockstar Dad comes a different guest each week, similar to what you do. And really hearing the impact of it on people in my industry or people in your industry or people, you know, who are actors or comedians, you know, you're a comedian, but comedians and, you know, all of the kinds of people that we have on our show that are fathers and how different it was for everybody with their kids, you know, versus how it is with our kids. Cause you know, you talk to somebody up in like the fucking, the Northeast, where they're like out in the middle of nowhere, they never shut down their schools. Like they didn't have to because they're isolated. Like nobody goes there because there's nothing to do, you know? And so it's just super interesting. And also, you know, as you say, you know, you really do find out, you know, who your friends are and all of that. I'm so bad about reaching out to people. And I even found myself doing it from time to time, you know, and especially if you saw that somebody was having something really bad happen or they were being affected by it. Or, you know, when Adam Schlesinger died, you know, pretty much all of us that knew him were all reaching out to each other. And,
can I quickly ask you, Jaret, if you don't mind, about, cause that's a unique situation right there, right? Mm-hmm. We've all lost people, and musicians have passed away, of course, over the years from various things, but I guess he was the first like guy in the community, right? The high profile, at least, that was a common thread between a lot of different people. So what was that like? I mean, it must have been the only good thing from that horrible situation must have been, as you say, that shared community of all being there for each other and reaching out and sharing memories and celebrating his life. And
he was such a special person and such an amazing musician, first and foremost, but a sweetheart of a person. And, you know, he had gotten himself, you know, for me, as you say, you know, he was, that's my world. I mean, he and I wrote High School Never Ends together, and that song was a hit, you know, and it's like, so we had that in common. We spent time together writing a couple of more songs that I don't think ever even got released, but, we wrote Choke together, and that's a B-side on Sorry for Partying, but, you know, I got to spend time with him, have beers with him. He came to my shows. I went to his shows. You know, and we stayed in touch. And, you know, you don't do that with everybody that you write songs with. He just sort of had, you know, it's like making movies, right? You're friends with people while you're making movies with them, and then you move on and you really don't. People are like, oh, are you best friends with such and such because you were in a movie with her? And it's just like, no. I mean, we spoke when we were on camera. That's it, you know. It was, first of all, let me say that it was gut-wrenching. And terrible. And that one hit me harder than any had so far as people affected or that passed away by it, because it was so close to home. I mean, I just looked at my wife and I'm just like, this is too close, man. I mean, this is like, this guy and I have posters on walls together, you know, like people think Bowling for Soup did Stacy's Mom and that's his song, you know, like it. Just, we have all of these ties and he was a friend of mine. I tell stories about that guy, you know, like it's what I'm saying is like, he was a part of my life and, you know, it wasn't just this face of some musician on TV for me.
Now, your lives were completely intertwined, weren't they? The DNA was shared. It was common.
It was there. And yeah, it was. And, you know, so I guess if any good came out of it, it was that to know just this how big his reach was and what a celebration it was for people to still to this, because it just passed the 1 year anniversary, actually. And there's still people putting out tributes and things like that. So, you know, I mean, that one was rough, man. I mean, that's, you know, besides, you know, close friends that I've lost to it, like, as far as like around here or from high school or whatever, like, I would say that one was definitely like a bat to the gut, you know. It's, very similar to the way that, you know, that, well, shit. I mean, I don't know. I guess you can't compare, but, you know, I had a really hard time when Chester passed away. And, you know, just when you lose people like that who are in your world, it's just so close. You know, you're just like, God damn, that's close. You know, tough.
There's one more thing I want to ask you in relation to the kind of corona stuff, and then we'll move on. We'll move backwards through time is where I'd like to go. But the last thing for me this year has been a really key time because I haven't been on the run, on the move. And I think it's definitely this way for me. Maybe it is for you, maybe it isn't. But my productivity and my overactive brain, you know, often means that I don't take care of shit in my life. So I'm on the move and I'm just getting it done. I'm out there doing the hustle and whatever's going on inside my head and my heart, I'm not really addressing or dealing with. And as we both know, over time, if that mounts up, it's coming back to bite you in a big way. Yeah. And what happened for me this year is I got to just hit the brakes. And initially it was terrible because I had to look in the mirror and go, oh my God, I've got to deal with all these problems that I've been hiding from for so long. And then I did. And like, to get through it all and come out the other side right now, and this is without income, I'm living at my parents' house, like, you know, there's still a lot of things that I'm waiting for and hoping for, but in myself, I'm the happiest and the most content and the most at peace I've ever been in my life because of this time to work on myself, to go in. And I wondered if you'd had any of that yourself. You mentioned spending an entire year with your son, which must have been probably the longest you've had since your career began, but
ever.
Is that like across the board something that you've loved and cherished as well and appreciated? Is that time for you just to take care of yourself, your family, and be there, be present in the moment?
Definitely exactly what you said. I mean, I think just having to wake up with ourselves without all of the distractions of the way that my life is crazy. And we, you know, my wife says that all the time. She's just like, your life is nuts. And it sometimes that's based on a text message that I get. And she's like, who just text you? And I'll say who it is. And she'll just be like, do you understand how insane that is? Like, you know, because, and I don't disagree. I mean, my life is crazy. And I've just the things that I, and the way that in the pace of it.
By design though, right? By design,
100%. I'm a micromanager who absolutely has to be in control of every little thing and all of that. And my brain never stops, right? It never stops. It's not a bad thing.
We're the same, dude. It's one of many things we share in common, man.
100%. I get tired, man. My brother came out on the road with us one time for 4 days, and he actually went to the hotel in London. He was in the UK, went to the hotel in London two days early because he was like, I can't keep up. This is crazy, Jared. Like, I don't know how you do it. And anyway, so slowing down, like that's the thing that I wondered. I early on, I was like, man, are we all gonna kind of not be in a hurry to answer emails and texts and stuff? You know, what's gonna be the balance here? Like, what's, you know, how is this thing, what's gonna change? One of the things that changed is you and I would probably be doing this interview over the phone. If we would have done this before COVID, we would have likely done this over some sort of audible thing. Now we've all gotten so used to being able to interact on the computer, that's going to change. So a lot of these people that are working from home are never going back to an office. It's an unnecessary expense. That's going to change, you know? So all of these things, but shit, I got off topic, but yes,
you're back in the business. I'm talking about not doing business.
I know. I became well aware of how I am. Not that I already was, but like, you know, when you're with an 8-year-old every day, all day, and he just is constantly going, "Are you still working? You know, are you working on something? Oh yeah, you're gonna. When do you think you'll be done? You know, you're working. You know, and you eventually start to hear that at first, and you kind of just like you're going, yeah, later, whatever. But then it starts to go, man, like the shit that he's gonna remember isn't gonna be no toilet paper. It's not gonna be, you know, the fact that we went without this or that his birthday party got canceled. He probably won't even remember that he's had two birthday parties not happen since this shit, you know. He's gonna remember that we ate dinner together every night and that we never missed an episode of America's Funniest Videos. And that, you know, like I could just stop in the middle of the day and go do something with him if I wanted to, you know? So yeah, I mean, for lack of a better word, you take stock of things, right? And you, you know, it definitely also with my older kids, not seeing them has been really, really tough on me. And they're teenagers, so it's hard because, you know, Matt, I started playing drums in bars when I was 13 years old. Like, I didn't fucking see my parents, you know, so but it's different when you just kind of can't, you know, like, you can't even be like, hey, you guys are coming over for dinner, whether you like it or not, you know, that's just not a thing. So, but yeah, I mean, I definitely got myself to the point of my hardest thing has been, which it's funny to go over this whole thing about all this shit that I did and all of the stuff that I continue to do and how I drive myself and how I'm a workaholic and all this. But I have to tell you that motivation because of depression is a motherfucker, man. I mean, there are definitely days where it's 11 a.m. and I'm like still in bed and I'm like, I don't think I'm going to get up today. You know, like I'm just going to stay here, you know, and
well, because the brain doesn't switch off, right? You might not want to get up and do stuff, but your mind isn't, you're not in a state of nirvana chilling out. Yeah. You know, you're in anxiety overdrive, and that's the worst, you know, fucking double kicker, because it's like, I want to do all this stuff, but I can't, and I hate myself for it, and shut up.
Exactly. It's too much, and everything's too much. You know, it's like, okay, you just need to do this. Like, so I did, I started, okay, so let's keep it simple. Let's do two easy things, you know? And just get a couple of things off the list, you know, and then we'll tackle something. And, you know, you always find that big hill you thought you had to climb was not really that big of a deal. It's like, you know, my child cleaning his room. It's like he'll every single fucking time he does it, he'll go, man, you know, once I really focus, it only takes me about 10 minutes. And it's like, yeah, you've been in there 7 hours, you know, like,
yeah.
So yeah, I mean, you know, that's the hardest battle for me has just been that, just the kickstart, you know, getting myself going. Sometimes it's enough to just know that people depend on you and people expect it. Sometimes it's not, you know, and, you know, luckily for me, those days are few and far between, but I am a human being. And if I've said anything over the last 8 years of being able to talk about this openly, I definitely am not fucking cured. So don't, if you have paid attention to my mental health journey, you know, and you're hearing this and Jesus Christ, he wrote 3 records and he did this, and he did, you know, that wasn't the easiest thing in the world for me every single day to get out of bed, you know? So, but yeah, you know, I've looked at the positives of this whole thing. And fortunately for me, I can find more positives than negatives through the whole year. And, you know, and I take a lot of, I'm very grateful for where my marriage is, you know, like, just having a year to just be here and just work on, you know, what was already an amazing relationship. I mean, we're best friends, but you know, love is a fucked up thing. Like we don't clean the kitchen the same way. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's shit she does annoys me and vice versa. I don't see her piles of shit around the house and she does it, or I see hers. I don't see mine. She doesn't see hers. You know, it's like, you know, those things. So I'm very lucky that I've had this year, just with Casey, and to be able to just to know, like, man, we got this shit down now. You know, it's awesome. It's been nice to go to bed in the same bed. And like I said, lots of positives, despite how horrible a lot of people have had it. I consider myself very lucky.
Yeah, I know a lot of relationships that have come undone in the last 12 months because of that pressure cooker of being just trapped indoors, no escape. And you're with the right woman. I've met Casey. She's great. You two are a great couple. And, you know, our lives have been very intertwined for me, Jaret. And we first met 10 years ago this year. Yeah, it's insane how long that's been. But then at the same time, it feels like really just yesterday that we were first meeting. And what's interesting to me, looking back through our friendship, because I've obviously been going down that, you know, wonderful memory road today in the lead up to chatting to you. 2013 was a crazy year, excuse the, you know, crass use of language, perhaps, for both of us. We were just getting to know each other, and we'd kind of had a couple of years of, you'd come into Kerrang Radio on every album cycle, and after a couple, we just, you know, we were hitting it off every time. You began doing a weekly appearance on my show, Jaret's Jams, which I have great memories of doing with you every week.
That's right.
And, you know, I'd say we were friends at that point already.
Sure,
and,
sure.
You know, I'd come out to LA and spend some time with you and Linus, and we'd be having this lovely time. And then 2013, Kerrang Radio shuts. I lose my dream job and I just spiral out of control and go off the deep end. Meanwhile, in your life, your marriage is falling apart. And I guess this is when the struggles in you start as well. So it's, you know, it's kind of strange that both of our lives at that point began to unravel in that way. We're both very positive, upbeat people, but there's obviously in both of us, I know, like a darkness that dwells within. I don't want to go too heavy on you because I don't want to bum you out, but I'd like to talk about this stuff with you if you're open to. Because we've never really done so before. You know, we've spoken in private a lot, but this is the first time we've really got into it in this way. On a public platform. So, Jaret, when for you do you think was the period in time when you started to notice these negative thoughts and feelings and they started to take over? Because they're always there, I think, in people like us, but they come to the forefront after either an event or, and that's with me, it was Kerrang closing down, losing my dream job. I thought my life was over, bang. And that was it. And since then, I've been dealing with varying degrees of depression. But that was the catalyst. What was yours, man?
Yeah, I mean, it's easy. It's an easy pinpoint. You know, I was here. I was, you know, 40 years old or so, and I had, you know, a wife and two kids, and I too had my dream job. Not only, you know, being in the best band in the world, but
who were they again?
Oh, you know, being in the greatest band that's ever lived. And, you know, and then I had just become Chuck E. Cheese, which is such a huge deal in America. I mean, there's 530 stores. It's like every kid knows who Chuck E. Cheese is, you know, and that's
ultimately you would have gone there as a kid, right? As well. So there's that
100%. Yeah. 100%. So the nostalgia of that, like I used to fucking love that mouse, man. And now I'm him and I still am. But, you know, and my kids are, my marriage had pretty much kind of started to fall apart a few years before. And there's no real easy way to put it, other than it's 100% because of my career choice. You know, I made so many sacrifices for both my marriage and for my band that really, there's so many things that Bowling for Soup probably would have or could have done had I not been in the relationship that I was in. And there's so much that I could have probably gotten or salvaged out of that relationship had I not been in Bowling for Soup.
Just very quickly there as well. That's something which a lot of people don't, I think, appreciate or fully comprehend or understand is, you know, this life, and I say more so, a lot more so with you than me, but I've, you know, toured and I've been on the road and I've been around that world. And when you make a living that way, it takes its toll, doesn't it? It takes its toll on your relationships, on your family life, on your personal life. And not to go, woe is the rock star, because it obviously is, as you said, a dream job. But there's a lot of emotional wear and tear that comes with the territory, isn't there? Hardcore.
Hardcore, man. I mean, hardcore. And you know, you always have to also understand place and time, right? Like, you know, through the big years of Bowling for Soup, we didn't have FaceTime and cell phones weren't what they are now. Like when I was in the UK, it was, you know, I'd run up an $800 phone bill just saying goodnight to my kids. You know, I mean, you know, and again, there's definitely no woe is me. Like I will complain about how boring it is to fucking be a musician because it's fucking boring.
Sound check.
Well, just sitting there. I mean, then what, you know, like, okay, you know, well, I've got press at 7, you know, and now I've got 2 hours. What the fuck can I do in 2 hours? You know, it's just the whole thing. But yeah, it's devastating to relationships. You know, I will say, I'll fast forward and say the beauty of what I've learned, you know, is that Casey comes out with me at least once a tour. And that really is helpful. Yeah. She's also very understanding because she does that of like why I don't like to talk on the phone when I'm on the road or why it's kind of hard to even get me to tell you about my day. Cause it's the fucking same day I had yesterday, you know? And again, I'm very appreciative. I'm doing what 99.99999% of people at one point in their life dream of doing. And I do it. But yeah, there's no question that my relationship with my ex was just fucking damaged through the really big Bowling for Soup years and sort of really exclamating coming out of like 2007 to 2009 and sort of like what, you know, what we were doing then to keep ourselves busy and whatever. And our relationship struggled because of it. And then both of us strayed, you know, which, you know, people probably tend to do when they're not getting the right attention. And you know, she was a miserable person at home with two kids. And I was a pretty miserable guy out on the road who wanted to be with my two kids. But at the same time, I still had no real understanding of depression and anxiety yet. I think it was just at that point where, you know, my doctor says, you know, it's kind of brewing down there, you know, like you're feeling it every once in a while, but you don't really realize that one day it just fucking comes out of the water. Well, you know, that it's easy. The catalyst for me was just that day of like, hey, we're going to get divorced. And to me, and nothing against my ex who, you know, we were definitely in love at one point and you know, it was real and we have two beautiful fucking kids and I would not take any one day out of that relationship. But, the hardest part for me was losing my family. It was knowing I'm not going to see my kids every day. Like I'm not going to see them eat. I'm not going to take them to school. I'm not going to see them when they get off the bus every day. Not going to see them. You know, I'm going to miss shit. Like, and now like we're going to have separate birthday parties and separate Christmases and just all of that. And then, you know, and then just the stress of like, well, now one of us has to move. And, you know, so, you know, when it all fucking came down on me and it had been a couple of years into me dealing with it and trying to get the diagnosis of it and of just what the hell was going on with me, you know, I would go through it. My doctor would go, you know, any one of these is a trigger. You have 10, you know, like a 2-year custody battle, a divorce, you moved house 3 times. I almost quit Bowling for Soup in 2013 to try and repair my relationship.
Is that why the final tour thing was laid out in the way that it was? Was that the reason behind that?
100%. And I've said that and not a lot. I mean, I kind of just came clean about that about a year and a half ago. And I've since sat down and cried and apologized to my band about it. And, you know, said, look, I was fucking willing to do anything, even break up the greatest thing that's ever happened to me besides my kids. I was willing to give this up just to be able to fucking wake up and see them every day, you know?
And that was a strange and hard time because Kerrang had gone at this point, and I remember being out on a few dates of that tour with you guys, and I was in my own weird headspace, and I remember being on your bus one night chatting to Chris, and Chris was like crying, and he was like, you know, my life's over after this, and there was a dark, sad cloud following, you know, the happiest band in town around, wasn't there? It was difficult, man.
That was tough for me to know how, I mean, Gary and I communicated very well and he was aware of everything. And Eric too, for that matter. I mean, really, you know, and honestly, like, I wasn't pulling wool over anybody's eyes. You know, I really did think that going out on top would be cool, you know, like, and I really did in my heart of hearts not want to run the band into the ground. You know, I also have to understand I was turning 40 years old. You know, I, you know, you don't fucking write fart joke songs and think you're going to be playing them at 50. And here I am fucking 49 years old and I'm scheduling shows so I can go play fart jokes at 50, you know, like that's literally a thing. I'm going to be in the UK as a 50 year old man next May playing songs about farts, you know? And so again,
hey, if it's good enough for the Descendants and they're doing it at 60, right?
100%. That's the lead up. Descendants and Bad Religion, man. I'll just, as long as you guys go, that'll be the fucking, that's the line. We just won't cross that. But that was very difficult. I saw him in tears several times on that tour. To be honest, as a defense mechanism, I just sort of kind of had to brush it off a little bit and just be like, dude, you know, we're still going to do stuff. We're, you know, your life isn't over, you know, but to him, touring is everything, you know, I mean, that's all that keeps him going. Bowling for Soup is all that man does. So you make a decision in our band. Okay. It's super easy. We don't just divide up money, which again, back to how we survived this pandemic, all of the money goes into the company and you get paid a salary and the salary is very modest. It's the same thing that we've been taking for 20 fucking years. And so if we can afford it, then you realize it's not that much. Now you get bonuses if we have tours, good tours and things like that. But the idea is, dude, if we don't work for a year, you're still going to get paid. Well, we've done that twice now. And one of them was because of me. And one of them is because of COVID. And we're still fine. So you have a choice in Bowling for Soup. You can just live off that. That's what Chris does. Or you fucking become a realtor like Gary, or you get 12 jobs like I do. You know,
I think the other thing as well, as you pointed out, is Chris is also single, which I can also relate to, is, you know, he doesn't have not only the career or the life at home, but the, you know, the family as well. So the band really is everything for him, right?
And by design though, too. I mean, he doesn't necessarily want to be by himself, but he's had two relationships, a marriage and an engagement go really, really bad. So the guy is not looking for that. That's, you know, so yeah, I mean, that he doesn't have all of that to support and he wants to, he lives his simple, awesome life. He has his friends that he goes, he plays darts, he plays poker, he spends time with his dog and he's in Bowling for Soup and it's fucking great, you know? But yeah, I mean, back to that. Yes, it was hard. It was really a fucking hard time. And, you know, I guess the one thing that I can say, again, I'm such a positive person and I don't really think that you'll ever find much that I don't find positivity in.
That's what, all right.
I know. And it drives my wife fucking crazy. I guess that's one of those things, right? Like when we're on the road and it's just, you know, back in the van, you know, when it gets just as bad as it's going to get. And I'm always like, well, but you know, I mean, fuck, we get to do this today, you know, it's like, and that's just how I am. That's when I knew that something was wrong with me. When I couldn't do that anymore. It was like, oh shit, I've lost my superpower. Like my superpower is to be able to have the flu, be pissed off about something, a death in the family and six other things wrong with me and meet somebody and make their fucking day. That's my superhero power, superpower. And I didn't have it anymore. And that's when I knew something was wrong with me. And, so yeah, I mean, it's so then, you don't really know what's wrong with you, you know, it becomes this whole thing of, all right, well, I'll go to a shrink. I'll go to my doctor. I'll do this. I'll try this medication. I'll try, this isn't working. This is really bad. This, you know, and that's a fucking 2-year process, you know, yep, of trying to figure out what the right balance of medication is, trying to get through the shit in your head that you think, you know, because I mean, I have a psychology major. I figured I was just giving myself therapy in my thinking all the time, you know, like, but yeah, I mean, you know, and I didn't have the easiest of childhoods but I had a good childhood, you know. I've had a wacky adulthood, you know, with finding my biological sisters 4 years ago and filling in a bunch.
Definitely want to talk to you about that in a little bit. Yeah.
We'll get to it in a second then. But yeah, so back to 2013, just fucking dark as it could be. Matt, I could fucking, you know, again, I was going into 2014 after all of that, going into 2014, I was in great shape. I just was doing what I had to do. And then I just found myself, I could get up in the morning on my weeks, get my kids to school, feed my dogs. And that was it. That was it. That was the whole day. The rest of the day was just fucking laying in the fetal position in my bed, not knowing what was wrong with me, with the worst feeling in the pit of my stomach that I've ever felt in my life. And it was just constant. And that was my life for a long time. And, you know, I'm very lucky that I met Casey, and that when I met her, I still was just starting really to try and figure it all out. And she was so patient and helpful and motivating and just there at the right time, you know? And you know, that's what happens, right? Everything sort of just comes in, and everybody says things happen for a reason. I actually do say that too. I a lot of people don't like that for that slogan, but you know, more often than not, I can sort of always see the benefits, even the really bad shit, you know? And that's just it, right? I mean, I went through that. This is what I was going to say earlier before I started crying, Matt. I love
you, man. You okay?
Yeah, I'm good. We, Bowling for Soup came out of that period, literally shot out of a cannon. If you saw us in 2014 or 15, every single person was like, holy shit. Like, these motherfuckers aren't fucking around now. You know, like, it was our download appearance in 2014. We fucking murdered. Every single review we got was as good as it could possibly get.
Not only did you murder it, this is something that I fucking love about you, is I was chatting to you moments before you were going on stage. And I was like, what are you going to play? What's in the set list?
Oh, yeah.
Because obviously a headline show, there's a lot more time to play a lot more stuff. You had maybe 30 minutes of download. And you were like, I don't know. We just get up there and we. Yeah. I was like, you don't even write a set list for a gig as big as that. And you're like, nah. And yeah. You know, some bands might say they don't, but they're there. There's a set list. You guys, and there's another story which I'll relay later on as well. But you just strolled up there and literally winged it and crushed it. And I was like, that's a fucking band right there.
The only time we write a set list is if we have pyro. So if we have pyro, there's a set list.
Set now, when it's going off. Exactly.
Yeah. Now I can call an audible, which is a football term in America, which means I can change things during the show. And I often do. But normally they'll know sort of what I'm going to do. So if I skip a song, then they know that I'm either trying to get to another song for the vibe of it, or I'm trying to get to something later, or I'm going to come back to that song later. But all of that's new. I mean, we have only had pyro for the last, what, 3 or 4 years. So working off a set list is very, very new. But you're exactly right. Yeah, I tell them what the first song. In fact, sometimes they'll forget to ask me. And like, you'll see Chris Burney will just be running over like, hey, what's the first song? You know, or the, you know, the starts, and it's just like, okay, hit an A or an E. That's usually right, you know, whatever we can do. But yeah, I mean, came out of that time shot out of a cannon, and you know, the band were so good to me during that time. As I said, my divorce wasn't awesome, but it, you know, we made it through. But the custody battle was about 2 years, and all of that during, you know, all of this, and just fighting to be able to have my kids half the time. You know, it's funny because I look back on that time. It's so weird because it wasn't that long ago, but now my kids are 15 and 18, and you know, they're not ever fucking here because they're teenagers. You know, it's just like, man, I hope that one day they know that, you know, that that fight took place just so that those few years we could have that. And I'm sure they will. But yeah, man, that was back to your original question. That's definitely when I knew that was the darkest of times and darkest time of my life. It's honestly the first time since I was an adult that I didn't feel invincible, that I didn't feel like I could get through anything, that I wasn't suicidal. So I don't want anybody, because I do know that that gets a hold of people sometimes. And if that does get a hold of you, please talk to somebody. And there are people that will listen. I did bottle it all up, and I had no fucking motivation to do anything at all. Nothing. I just didn't give a shit. So I threw myself into just, you know, I drank a bunch, probably too much. I had a lot of fun.
Was it actually fun? Because I have this thing, like, I've been through periods like that where I think I'm having fun at the time, and I look back and I'm like, man, I don't know whether that was a lot of fun. You know, it is and it isn't, right?
When you go into a bar and everybody's like, hey, are you all right? And you're like, what the fuck are you talking about? They're like, yeah, you fell backwards in your chair last night. You had to fucking, you know, your friends had to carry you to the car and shit. And that's embarrassing, you know, and not as much as I joke about us drinking and as much as Bowling Pursuit does drink on the road and love to party and all of that, you know, there's a control to it. You know, you have to be able to live your life. And I wouldn't say that that was my biggest obstacle at all, but it definitely wasn't helping.
The mindset which you drink in as well, right? Like if you're around friends and it's a celebration, you're on tour, it's a good time. It's okay to knock a few back. But if you're deeply, deeply unhappy in yourself, you're on your own, that's no time to be drinking. And I've been down that road so many times. And yeah, it's a horrible feeling to be like fucking depressed and drunk. And you feel like you're losing control, don't you?
Yeah. And I wasn't the best person. I mean, I had never really been much of like a womanizer, at times. But, you know, I kind of went through a bad period there, and I hurt people. And, you know, I got regrets. You know, I do. Fortunately for me, I went to therapy. You know, you go to therapy and you work through that forgiveness of yourself before you can start working on everybody else, you know, and which sounds stupid if you've never been through it, you know, like if you're just like, if people are like, well, just fucking say you're sorry to yourself. And then, you know, but it's just not that easy. It's, you know, when you really dig through there and start to think about all that stupid shit that you did, or just, you know, again, it's embarrassing that, you know, you let yourself get to that point. And I just didn't fucking care anymore. I really didn't. I just, you know, it was tough. It was a tough, tough time.
I will say this, my friends, the Lunch Drunk Love album, which came out in 2013, which I'm presuming would have been a product of all of this going, you know, that was going on in your personal life, because that album is kind of a breakup record, but then it's also your Falling in Love with Casey record. It's like both in one. That, for me, I think is the best album you guys have ever put out. I think it's so honest and heartfelt. And you know, you're obviously this entertaining, fun band. That's what you're known for. And I remember the first song which really made me see you guys in a different light was around the time we first met, which was Turbulence off Fishing for Woos. I was like, this is Bowling for Soup. I couldn't believe it. It's such a beautiful, heartfelt, incredible song. And then you came out with Lunch Drunk Love around 2013 when Kerrang was closing down and your marriage and all of that was happening. And I was like, this is a different band, man. Did you feel like you were going into different writing territory with that record? And did want to go there?
That was all written. Casey actually comes in later. That record was literally written during all of this. And in fact, I will tell you this, and this is the God's honest truth. My ex and I decided we were getting a divorce over text message while I was in the vocal booth singing that fucking album. And I was texting, and Linus is, you know, he's like, hey man, you ready? And I'm like, I just need 1 second. I guess I'm getting a divorce. And he's like, oh shit. You know, and Eric came in with a beer and, you know, whatever. I mean, I wasn't upset because I knew it was coming. And we were both ready. We were exhausted. We had done, you know, we had done therapy and together. And, you know, I happen to know for a fact that I was going in there thinking we were going to rescue it. And she was going in there going through the motions. I don't blame her. She, you know, she went through a lot with me and I went through a lot with her. You know, I get it. She was done over it. So I think it was more for appearances for her to be able to say to, you know, family and friends that, you know, hey, we tried kind of thing. And I know that because, you know, I saw some messages that I shouldn't have seen kind of thing.
Yeah, the worst.
Yeah. You got to stay out of people's phones, man. I have never gotten into anybody's phone, but two times in my life, that was one of them. And it was just right there. It's not like I had to dig. But both times, it was fucking real bad. Like, you just don't get into people. If you don't trust who you're with, then I don't know what to tell you because it just never goes. It never goes well.
Coming back from it, is there? Once you've seen that stuff,
yeah. And plus, it makes you an asshole. Like, yeah. You know, you're going to open this whole conversation about trust with that individual. They're going to turn that motherfucker back around on you for getting into their phone. And then you're just, it's a standoff in the middle of a street where nobody's really right.
Yeah.
You know, and they're, you know, and then you draw your guns and it fucking hurts and you both say shit that you don't mean. And, you know, there's better ways to work things out. You know, I guess in hindsight, I'm glad I know because I don't feel like I failed. I feel like I failed before then, you know, like at least I was going in there with the right ideas and the right, you know, level of trying again. The problem with me was, and this isn't good, but I wasn't trying to really keep my relationship with her as much as I was trying to keep my family together. And that's fucked up, man. I would tell me in a heartbeat, like, dude, you're going to be fine. Get out of that marriage so that you and she can both be happy. And then your kids are going to be happy, you know, because our kids didn't even know that we were miserable because we didn't fight. You know, we just didn't.
It's like that outdated phrase, isn't it? Stay together for the kids. It's the worst thing you can do, I think, is stay together for the kids. If the partnership is toxic, because it's just, that's going to feed into their soul, psyches from a young age and color their opinions on relationships.
Yeah. I think back to I guess it's about 3 months before she moved out. We had taken the kids to Disney and, I think about that trip all the time, just because in the back of my head, I knew, but it wasn't out there yet. You know, like I just knew, I was like, just with things that would be said, things that I would say, or she would say, or things that we would do to try to be nice to one another. And it just felt gross. I there's so many vivid memories of me going, oh fuck man, we're for sure getting a divorce. You know, like I'm not going to say that, but, and you just wonder, you know, how well we hit it, you know, like I think we did a really good job, but I don't think everybody does, you know. Your kids can be really affected by that shit. And I don't think anybody should ever settle or stay in any relationship that they're not happy in, because life is short. And I fucking have said that my whole life and I did it, you know? So it's just hard, you know, it's like, going back to relationships, it's like, when you're getting that divorce, right? And we sat out on the driveway and we decided we're having a beer together. And it's like, we're going to be best friends forever. Even if our spouses don't like it, we're going to be best friends forever. And I'd say that to like my friend Ty or whoever, and they'd be like, yeah, right. Like that's going to happen. I mean, no, we really are. No, that shit did not happen at all. And the minute, you know, somebody, you start to get in a different relationship or this, or the first argument about the kids, all of that, you know, into this big swirly tornado. Oh man.
How is it now?
It's good. I mean, you know, now it's very, you know, it's taken us a long time to just get to the point. We're not buddies. It's business. You know, she still owns a part of, you know, all of my stuff that I created while we were married, and will forever, because we were a partnership in that we were married. So there's a business relationship with that stuff, which is just, you know, just making sure all the accounting is done and all that. And then when the kids need something, you know, it's an email or a text, you know, that's it. You know, it's definitely not any sort of a relationship. I don't think there's any love lost, but I think we both know that each other is a good parent. And so, I know she's a great mom, and my kids have a great relationship with her, and I'm a fucking fantastic dad, and my kids have a great relationship with me, and that's the best we can do. You know, that's it.
How long before you begin to remember that you put so much positivity and light into the world and people's lives? You mentioned earlier on about these stage it shows you've been doing through COVID and this community that you've, you know, been building in this time. But I've been around you guys a lot, and I've seen like your fan base. Every band says, right, our fans are the best fans in the world. And every band, I'm sure, believes it, because for them that they are. But there's like a hyper sensitivity and like gang mentality, but in a good way, that, you know, follows the Bowling for Soup camp around, and everything you do, there's so much love and support for it. How long does it take you to get back on your feet in that sense and feel like this is what I'm here to do, this is what I'm meant to be doing? Because you lose that confidence, right, in the initial phases of your depression, and I'm sure it still wrestles in time to time. But when do you get that back and start to feel like, yeah, I'm a good person, I'm a good entertainer, I'm a good father, let's get back to doing what I do?
First show back after all of that, after that break.
Amazing.
We did a bus trip up, I guess it was in 2014, maybe Warped Tour, and like a run with the Dolly Rots or something. That aspect of me, it's hard for me to talk about, and especially in a public platform, because I don't want to seem conceited, and I definitely don't want to seem like I am.
Let me say it for you then, Jaret. You know you're good at what you do.
I am really, really.
And you can say that. I don't like false modesty, man. I'll tell this as an example, right, to back up what you're saying. You did a solo tour, Heartache and Hilarity, and you landed in, I think, Wolverhampton, I think was the first.
Yeah.
Location on that tour. I came to the show to see you and catch up, and again I was like, so Jaret, how's this show going to pan out? It's stories and songs, what's the running order, what's the idea behind it? And you're like, I don't really know. I was like, what? He's like, I haven't really got a set. I've been thinking on the flight over what I'm going to do. That was the first time you'd turn your thoughts to it. And again, you got on stage and you just winged it. You made up a show of stories, and anybody else in that situation, acoustic guitar, no band to hide behind, would have crumbled. The thing would have gone off the rails. You know, it would have fallen short of being an entertaining night out. But you can do that shit, man. You are an entertainer, so you can forget the false modesty.
Well,
you're a rock star, dude.
I know. Look, I guess probably the biggest it's funny, you know, this, like I said, this pandemic has brought out a lot of love within my own camp and my own friendship group and my group of my peers and all of that. And Chris Burney, just one night, I said something about myself, and I often say degrading things about myself to make it funny and to, you know, where it lightens the load or whatever. And Chris Burney, who never says anything like this, just goes, "Do you know how happy you make people?" He was like, "Just, do you know like the impact or how many lives you've affected or whatever?" And I was just like, "Okay, stop it, you know, yada yada," because, you know, yeah, I do. And this pandemic has been super, I have a lot of awareness of that. I have a lot of awareness of like, of the power that I have to put positivity into the world and to make people realize that they're worth something. You know, I do, I have that ability and that power. And I think the most important part of me being able to do that is people know that I fucking mean it. You know, like here's the thing about me. When I go out on stage and I say, "We're Bowling for Soup, we're the greatest band that has ever lived," I'm obviously joking.
What?
Or am I? Like, so, you know what I mean? Like, I think a lot of people are like, "Oh man, that's funny. Wait, is he being sick?" You know what? They fucking might be, you know, like there's just that thing of like, and obviously that's a thing, but whenever I sit there and I tell you, "Hey, you know, this is a song about, you know, the girl that I had to leave, I had to make a choice between the band and a girl early on. And this song's called Cold Shower Tuesdays and yada, yada, whatever. Those tears that come down their fucking faces are real because they know that I mean exactly what I'm saying. And I am not selling you a bag of dumb shit. You know, like I'm just putting myself into the world. And that's not who I set out to be at all. I didn't set out to be the guy who
moves who people.
Was, yeah, I really didn't. I like to make jokes. And, you know, as you know, I mean, I pride myself on being really funny. And I know I'm really funny. I do. As you said, we don't have to tiptoe around it. Right. But I also know that there's more to me than that. And I know that a lot of people, it's funny. Somebody posted a picture of me the other day and it just, you know, just the comments that it gets, it's so touching. It's so moving. But one person was just like, you know, gosh, we've got to make sure that guy stays around forever, you know, kind of thing. And it just, the comments on that is like, what the fuck would we do without this guy? And, you know, yada, yada. So obviously that's a lot of pressure and I'm not going anywhere, but you know, I am so thankful that I've been able to move people like that, that I've been able to make that kind of impact through whether it's my words or my music or both. You know, it's not what I set out to do, but as you say, I fucking do it pretty good.
Well, even just on a personal level, man, early on to me, you would go out of your way to say and let me know. You'd be like, Matt, you're the best interviewer in the world. After Howard Stern, you're the best interviewer in the world. And at that point in my career, I was only a year or so into this thing, right? And you and my friend Joel from this band Airborne, you two were the first guys to put your arms around me, you know, literally, metaphorically, whatever you want to use, and let me know that I was talented. And that I was special, and you were encouraging and supportive, and you lifted me up from day one. And that quality in you shines in your music, in your stage show, and in your personality, man. You're the real deal. You're a big.
I stand behind that.
Biggest heart in the world.
I still to this day say that you are the best person that's ever interviewed me in my life, and just also the fact that you can continue to do so after 10 years. Of knowing me and knowing and asking me questions through all of this shit that we've, you know, both been through and beers that we've shared and tears that we've shared and relationships coming and going and all of that shit, you know, and just the fact that we can sit here and have a chat like this and you can continue to make it fresh and new. I mean, that's you, man. That's not me. I'm just answering the questions and doing what I always do, you know? So, you know what? Here's the thing. I don't even think Howard Stern's the best because he fucking interrupts people too much. Like, you don't, you got to go back and listen to his interview with Jonah Hill because Jonah Hill will cut him off and Jonah Hill will go, that's fine, but let me finish my thought. And he just keeps doing it over and over and over again. It's really fun.
Well, there's been so many moments, man. Another night that springs to mind for me just whilst we're reminiscing is, you'd come to London, you were doing a show in Camden at Dingwalls, and I'd had you into the new radio studios I was working in at the time to record a session. And then you and Ryan left. And then after that, my boss takes me on the roof of the building and tells me, oh, by the way, you're going to LA tomorrow. When you get back, your job won't be here. You remember that night? And I come to see you at the show and I'm like, dude, I lost my fucking job today. And you're like, what? But we were just there. And I went to LA the next day, no job, just like, and again, you were like, you're going to be fine, dude. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. And I believe that. And look, I mean, you know, again, yeah. I mean, dude, all of us in a sense are living at our parents' house right now. Right. I mean, nothing is fucking normal in the world. You're still doing what you love. You know, you're still putting out content. And you know what? The end of the thing is in sight. And then you're going to be working again and all of this is going to go. I remember that day very, very well. You know, you were white as a ghost when you walked into the dressing room. I remember exactly where we were. I remember that dressing room. And I remember that you were going on holiday, right? So you're like leaving the next day for holiday, knowing that you're coming back to no job.
Yep.
Yeah.
People like me and you have that ability, man. I'm going to just throw myself modesty aside. We have the ability, you sort of alluded to it earlier, when there's the hurdle in front of us, right? We'll find a way to either go to the side, under, over. This pandemic has shown us like, okay, you're going to need to just go over into this lane for a while now. And that's going to be you for a bit. And I've seen that in so many people this year, so many people that I admire. The ones that I admire the most are the ones that have that adaptability and drive to be able to just roll with the punches sometimes, because life ain't easy, man. And this year, I think, has hammered that home for everybody. But the best that we can do is be the best versions of ourselves for the people in our lives. And really, even when it seems like it's impossible, just keep going, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, yeah, that's it, right? I mean, you know, it's, you know, life's a funny thing, man. It's, I'm in an interesting part of my life where I've had to take stock for the first time of like relationships in my life that are toxic and the ones that just don't make me feel good. And some of those relationships are very close to home. And, you know, I'm actually not speaking to my parents right now, which I always thought, well, how do you not speak to your parents? Well, a lot of that comes from, as I said, you know, I discovered who my biological father was about 4 years ago, and I've met my biological sisters. And
how's that process been, Jaret? Has it been like gaining a whole new side to the family and amazing?
It's been amazing, dude. I mean, they have just welcomed me. I mean, you know, our parents had affairs and I'm the result of it. And they didn't know about me till they were in their 50s and I was in my 40s. And man, we, you know, before COVID, we were vacationing together, spending holidays together. They're coming down to visit soon.
Are they all girls? Am I right in thinking that?
They're all girls. Yeah. They're all girls. So, and then I have a brother who is my mom had me and my brother. So he's my half brother. And, you know, I was adopted by the man I call my dad when I was three. And, you know, so again, I had a good life you know, are you going to play on your iPad? Okay. You can go in your room and play on your iPad while I'm working. How was school today? Really good. How was the bus ride home? No problems?
No problems.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, good. I love it. All right. Well, you got karate coming up, but you got about an hour to play on your iPad.
Yay.
Enjoy. Okay.
I love it. And that kid, I won't keep you much longer, Jaret.
Oh, he's the fucking best, dude. He's awesome. But yeah, man, I got, you know, I met my sisters. Two of them were pretty apprehensive about the whole thing because it drums up, you know, our father had passed away. It drummed up a bunch of stuff in their life that they just didn't know about. When they found out that their cousins knew about it and they were the only ones, and that was hurtful. And so then now my mom won't give me any information, and she has, you know, this way of thinking about the whole thing. And here I am, I just feel like I was lied to my whole life. And so, you know, so what I was trying to say is that I've just gotten to this point of where it's like, you know, that relationship doesn't make me happy. I'm just not going to have that relationship. I mean, you're not born into the world. Cause I do. I see so many people like, man, yeah, I'm like fucking, you know, this guy is such an asshole and yada, yada. And I'm just like, why do you choose to spend time with that person?
I even think that can be applied, and some people might not agree with this and think it's too harsh, but I think family members, man, if family members don't improve your life.
Yeah.
Get rid.
I agree. Dude, you know, and you can go back in history all you want, but like when you were 15, you fucking left, you know, and like, and you didn't go home for Christmas when we were cavemen, you know, you were trying to find a brontosaurus or some shit, you know, like,
You're moving on with your life. Yeah.
Moving on with your life. And so I think those relationships that you do keep with relatives, hey, fucking A, great. And I love, and I hope to God my kids want to have a relationship with me forever. But if I become a toxic person, then fucking write me off. You know, it's up to me to figure out what the issue is. You know, it's all right there. But so yeah, I mean, it's not a bad place to be honest, man. I mean, not many people in the world that I've had to write off, but it, you know, it certainly feels good to be in a place of love you know, not being a fucking shithead and, you know, to have it controlling my mental health and, you know, my band going awesome. And, you know, I've got a country record coming out, and me and Kelly just released a record a year ago. And
Well, let me ask you about this country record, dude, because there's a Bowling for Soup song where you're singing. It's one of my favorite Bowling for Soup songs. And it's funny that you mentioned you're doing a country record, because I was taking a walk through the woods the other day. And this song, it's the last song maybe on Drunk Dynasty. And you're singing about some advice your granddad gave you. And he's like, hey, Jamar. And it's a country, it's Bowling for Soup, but it's a kind of country song. And I was, and obviously you're from Texas. And I was like, man, these guys, or even if it's just you solo, you got to do a country record. So that's happening, or it's already happened. What's going on?
Happening. It's being mixed right now. Something I've been talking about forever. You know, I've always kind of written, there's a few, there's All Figured Out. You're talking about Drinking Beer on a Sunday. You know, there's a few songs here and there that have that country thing. To be really honest, like if I were to ever play you, like, okay, here's a new song that I wrote, it's going to be a Bowling for Soup song, but they all sound country when they first start out, because they're all written with one of these acoustic guitars back here.
And you're a great storyteller, and that's what country music is, isn't it?
That's all it is. Yeah, that's all it is. And I love having a beginning and an end, and you know, all of those things. So, I am really, really, really proud of it. And it's not funny. I mean, there's funny aspects to it and all of that, but it's a legitimate, you know, country record. And
little bit of an advanced listen when you've got a track or two?
You know what? I will send you a couple of songs. In fact, we're mixing right now, and I should start getting some songs back pretty soon. But man, I'm going to go for it. I'm going to actually release it. And this is, you know, nothing away from Bowling. Here's the great thing about my life now. As you know, there was the time when I was going through the divorce and then the custody and you know, and us putting the band back together. Not really. I mean, you know, we didn't have to put it back together, but I, you know, whatever.
We're back out on the road.
We're doing shit again. Right. But still, if I were gone more than 2 weeks, the way that it works is I wouldn't get my week back with my kids. So if I were gone 2 weeks, I wouldn't see my kids for a month kind of thing. So really 10 days was the maximum I could be gone so that I could still get them for 4 days on either side of the tour. Right. It's math, Matt, you know, it's just math. But so anyway, now it's like, well, shit, I don't have to do that anymore. I mean, my daughter graduated, my son's 15. He's so fucking busy. I mean, I wouldn't see him during the week anyway. Like, we're like to the point of like having dinner every couple of weeks now, or, you know, come over one weekend.
When you can whatever. Fit you in.
He's living his life. You know, he's busy. Yeah. And again, that's what I started to say earlier. I was playing bars when I was 13. Like, I didn't see my parents, you know? And my kid's eight. His life is just kind of falls into place, and he's going to be here when I start, when I finish. So my wife can come out on the road because we have such a good support system. So, man, I can fucking go for it, you know, like and still not affect what Bowling for Soup does at all. And so I'm like, you know what? The time is right. I started it right before COVID hit, and I was actually going to do it here in Denton. But what happened was I ended up writing it with my friend Zach, and I went to Nashville back.
Got to go to Nashville, right?
Yeah, I wanted to go to, I mean, I really wanted to do it in Denton because Texas country is a real big deal, but I thought there would be something cool. And I was right. It was just cool to go to Nashville and just be there and do the record. But I got all of my players are hired guns, and they're all really, really fucking good. And so, man, I'm really going to do it. It's, I think you're going to be surprised. It's, and maybe you won't be, I don't know.
I won't be surprised, man, because I've seen you do the thing in various forms, and I know you're a talented guy, man. And I know that whatever you put your hand to, because of just your care over the craft, like, you never half-ass anything. So if you're going to do something, I know you're going to do it all the way, and it's going to be great. And as I said, I just heard that tune the other day, and I was like, this guy's a country singer. Of course he is. And what a great thing to be discovering as you enter like this new chapter in your life, this new phase. I can see you as that country fucking bluesman out there on the road, just your guitar and your lady rolling into town.
No reason, man. You just go in and you hand the band charts and you fucking get up there and you do your shit, you know, like it's, you know, but I will probably put together a band and do some traveling and do some shows. I'm not expecting, you know, here's the great thing. I even say this in my, I write a lot about Bowling for Soup and on the country record because that's my life, you know, But I say, looking back is easy now. We've come so far. No more shooting for the stars. Like, it's the we've already done everything.
You've done it, man. You've done the thing.
So I don't have to sit down and write a Bowling Pursuit song or a country song under any sort of pretense or desire, really. I guess, I mean, you know, if one were to hit, that would be great, but it's not going to really affect my life that much. Like, you know, obviously the money would be fucking awesome, but like, it's not something I haven't done. It's not going to change the course of what I'm doing. So it's just nice to be able to put music out. By the way, this new Bowling for Soup record, I'm telling you, I know most everybody, you love Lunch Drunk Love. Most everybody likes Drunk Enough to Dance. And then the biggest record is Hangover. This one gives all three a run for their money. And I am not one of those 49-year-old people who is putting out an album trying to beat shit that I wrote 25 years ago. I did not try to do that, but it is really, really good. And
one thing I've noticed about you, Jaret, as well, is your voice. Like, you know, you'll go watch a 50-year-old singer and you're like, oh man, those pipes ain't what they used to be. But you somehow seemed, and I mean this sincerely, you somehow seem to get better at singing. Yeah. You can seem to sing like even higher and hold the notes for longer the older you get.
Yeah, I've been really lucky in that my range has gotten broader, bigger. As I'm a little hoarse today because we just opened up. I built a swimming pool over COVID because my 8-year-old had fucking nothing to do last summer and it was brutal. And I was like, I don't give a shit. I'll just go into debt. We'll build a pool. So we built a pool and we were out there all weekend and I'm yelling at him to stop running for the whole weekend. So I am
not match fit. You've been off the road for too long. That's what it is.
Yeah. My range, for some reason, it you know, I'm really, really lucky when my voice is concerned because it's gotten better and stronger. I never lose it unless we're recording a DVD in London.
That was when I was with you, I think, wasn't it?
That's right. Yeah, it's the first time I've ever fucking lost my voice was in Bristol the night before that. And then I tried to do that DVD and spent 30,000 pounds on that thing and just flushed it down the toilet.
You can't win them all, Jaret. You can't win them all.
That was that. When I told the band that, I was just like, yeah, guys, we're going to flush this. And, you know, I never really talked about the budget with you, but 30,000 pounds. And everybody was like, oh, God, you know, it just makes you sick to your stomach, man.
And final question for you, man. This has been so good reconnecting with you, dude, as I knew it would be.
You too, man. I miss you, dude. I really do. And I you know, you want to come out on tour and do Matt Stocks DJ and ride my bus? That offer's always open, man.
I would 100% love to do that, man. I would love to do that. And as soon as the shows are on, you make the call, man, and I'll be there with bells on. It'd be a great honor.
Yeah.
The final question is this: Jarinus 2.
Yeah.
Is there going to be a follow up? Is that ever going to happen? The songs must be there.
They are, and it's if you ask us together, we're going to say it's just, we both got so busy and Linus is now doing photography. He's shooting.
Is he really?
Video.
Nice.
Yeah. He's doing really, really well. And so he does sort of like exotic photography, but he's starting to do regular shit now too. He's doing video, but he does a lot of film and TV commercials. So he's always really, really busy. We have 4 songs in the can. And all he has to do is finish his parts. But that's been like that for about 3 years. So you might want to just give him a little Matt Stocks nudge and just be like, Jaret says that in order to get new Jarinus, you're going to have to get in the studio and do your parts.
I'm going to do it right after this Zoom chat. I'm going to hit him up because I've been thinking a lot about LA recently. I don't know if it's just because it's been shows that I've been watching. And it's one of the first places I want to get to once, you know, this opens up. And one of my favorite memories of all time will always be the night me, you and Linus had out. And it was Steel Panther at the House of Blues.
Yeah.
And then Seventh Veil. It was our Motley Crue night out on the town.
Yeah.
It was so much fun, man.
Matt,
that night in great regard.
Matt Sorum from Guns N' Roses got up and played drums that night.
Mm-hmm. He was there. Ricky Ratman was there. Dave Navarro was there. Dave Navarro.
That's right.
Sorry. It was like a who's who of Hollywood rock and roll.
That's right. Yeah, that was a big one, actually, because I'd seen them so many times. And, you know, it'll just be like, hey, the singer for Who the fuck is that guy? You know, but yeah, that was a big night. That was a really good one.
And then we both obviously later up wound up touring with Steel Panther, not together.
Yes. Yeah, we did. And talk about it a lot. Actually, I'm doing something with Darren that I can't talk. Sticks that I can't talk about. But he'll be, it's cause it's his shit. But we're talking about doing more together, later. I mean, you know, it's funny. We did that arena tour with them. And, you know, this one thing that we haven't talked about is that since 2013, since that break, our audience in the UK and in America are growing. We're playing bigger places than we were before that with zero radio play. And
well,
all
some
just,
radio play, Kerrang radio. Yes, I had your back. Yes.
No. I know you. I mean now.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah.
So we had, yes, again, you guys fucking, you know, it was awesome. I mean, honestly, Kerrang TV is the reason Bowling for Soup actually exists to this day, because them putting that the bitch song on in just constant rotation was all the ammo the American label needed to let us do that second record, which brought You Girl All the Bad Guys Want, which is the fucking, you know, that's really the dynamite after the spark was lit, so to speak.
Yeah, the bitch song over here was the one, wasn't it? I remember that being that being a big hit. And also, funnily enough, I used to work for Scuzz as well. I don't know whether I interviewed you for Scuzz or not, but I was on there for a few years. And the very, very, because that's obviously now gone as well, Another One Bites the Dust. The very, very, very last video that they played before they came off the air was
Girl
All the Bad Guys Want. Right. Yeah. Crazy. Yeah. But yeah, the audience is just consistently, steadily
growing. It's growing. Yeah, I mean, like, we're literally to the point where it's like, okay, we could do arenas with Steel Panther, but we're not opening. We're going to co-headline now, you know? It's like, so, you know, again, we're very, very lucky. Man, the BBC just played Girl of the Bad Guys Want this weekend, you know, not Radio 1. You know, it's just, it's so cool because you guys have national radio. So here, it could be on, it's on some station somewhere all the time, but it's never as big of a deal as if fucking Radio 1, like, you're on Radio 1, dude, like, our entire country is listening to this right now, you know, you fucking crazy. But yeah, man, that was a great night. And, you know, I'm super, you know, excited for you to get back out there. I want to see your stand up sometime, man. I know that you, obviously, I know you've had to not do it for a long time. So when you start working that shit out again, let's fucking,
I'll run through some stories and jokes with you, because, you know, your input and feedback would be invaluable. Do you do stand up? Have you ever performed?
So I did improv comedy for a long time. That's how I got the Chuck E. Cheese gig. Somebody saw me in improv comedy, and just the fluctuations that I can do with my voice and being able to, we did a bunch of things that where I would be sort of like the main guy. So we would do like a rock opera based upon audience suggestions and shit like that. Stand up, I have never done. I do sort of have bits and things like that I'll sometimes work into a Bowling for Soup show, but I try not to do it because it does become like I'm just up there doing stand-up and the other guys are just standing there, you know?
Maybe you could do some of that with the country stuff that yeah, would just sit quite nicely in that format. Maybe
we'll see but yeah, it's always been a big desire. I just I need to sit down and write 3 or 4 minutes and go do it.
I'm sure once you do it, you'll be out there doing an hour special before long, mate, because that's how you roll.
Man, I would love it, man. Well, dude, again, I miss you, brother, and thank you for this. It's about time.
Thank you, man. And just thank you for all the years of friendship and support, man. You've always been a champion of me personally and professionally, and I love you to bits, man. I hope you know that.
Love you, too. And same here, man. And I appreciate everything. And dude, we've been through a lot. Let's fucking do it for another 10 years and do a bunch of cool shit.